Let's take a look at the CRA sequence of instruction. The C stands for concrete, the R stands for the representation, and the A stands for the abstract. And the CRA sequence of instruction is a way for us to scaffold students' thinking to build a real deep understanding of what's going on abstractly in mathematics. The first thing that we need to do is we need to make sure that we address the concept that's happening. So for our example, we're going to be using addition. So we're going to look at some of the concepts that students are going to need to be able to work with addition in a CRA type of sequence. The second thing we need to do is get students working concretely. So moving objects around to making sense out of the procedures that we're looking at for addition. Then we're going to have to purposefully plan for and teach the connections between the concrete and the representation. So this is going to be the same kind of modeling that's happening with the students, the same kind of thinking, but it's going to look different. Here it's concrete objects, here they're going to be drawing pictures. Then we're going to let students practice with the representation before we very explicitly teach the connections between the representation and the abstract. And then we're going to allow students to practice in the abstract. And then finally, what you're going to see is that students need to be able to self-monitor their own thinking. So we have to give them opportunities to practice with these different representations and have some choice and some ownership over how they're going to make sense out of the problem. So we're going to work through this type of sequence. We'll use addition problem as an example, and we're going to begin up here with our concept. So if I'm going to work with the number 17, I need a student to be able to model that number. And so what that might look like at first is students are going to have 17 ones. Okay, so we've got, there's 5, 5, there's 15 and 17. So here we can see 17 ones. And that is one way to model this number, and it's how a lot of students think about the number 17. But we need some more efficiency in this process. So one of the things that we need to make sure we have conceptually developed for students is that we can group 10 of these ones, and out of 10 of those ones, I can replace that with 110. And we can see that those are equivalent, first, because they're the same size, and second, because we can count each of the individual blocks and match it up one-to-one with each of the blocks on that rod of 10. So once we have that developed, that 110 is equivalent to 10 ones, we can start to model the number 17 as 110 and 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 ones. So now I've modeled this number 17 based on place value. And that's one of the concepts that we're going to need to have developed before we start into a CRA sequence of instruction. So now we're ready to begin looking concretely at how we're going to have students deal with addition. So we've already shown how to model our number 17. We're going to use that number, and let's say that we're adding the number 16 to that. So we want students to be able to work with the problem 17 plus 16. Well, the first thing we would do is model our 17, so I have to identify how many 10s in 17, and that's 1 10s, and 7 ones, so there's 5 and 7 ones. Now I need to model 16, so 16 has 1 10, and 6 ones. So now we have the numbers 17 and 16 modeled concretely. Now the addition is putting together of these groups. So we're going to put our groups together, and I can see now that I have 2 tens. And if I start moving my ones up, one of the things that we notice is we get a set of 10 ones up here. So remember before we had talked about that concept, we know that if we have 10 ones, that we can replace that, those 10 ones, with 110, and that would be an equivalent trait. So now we see that we have 3 tens and 3 ones. 3 tens has a value of 30, and 3 ones has a value of 3. So when we put that together, we know that 17 plus 16 is going to equal 33. And that's how students would work on this problem concretely. As we get students comfortable working concretely, then we have to teach them to make the jump from the concrete to the representational. We can't just then start working with representations. We need to make sure students understand that transition. So let's take a look at one way we might teach that transition. So I think one of the easiest ways to do this is when we're using place value blocks is to have our students draw those blocks. So for example, if we take a look at the number 33 that we were just looking at, one of the things we might do is have students trace these. When they trace their tens, and they circle their ones, when we remove the concrete objects, we can see a representation here. So now we make this a little bit neater. We can draw our tens to look like this and our ones to be circles. So that's an easy way to show how we're going to transition from the place value blocks to a representation that will represent our place value blocks. So when you've made that connection for students, one of the things that's important is the thinking's not going to change. What is going to change is they're no longer going to use place value blocks. They're going to be comfortable working just with the representations. So let's go back to our addition problem and take a look at that same problem using the pictures that we just created. We won't need our place value blocks anymore. And we were talking about the problem 17 plus 16. So again, I have to model 17. That was 110 and 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 ones. And 16 is 110 and 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 ones. And then recall that we talked about addition, meaning the putting together. And we also wanted to check for a group of 10 to see if 10 ones could be traded in for 110. And what we see is we do have two sets of five there. So I can cross those out and give myself another 10. So now if I come down below, I've got three tenths and three ones. If I wanted to write that again, three tenths and three ones, which have values of 30 and 3, meaning my sum for 17 and 16 is going to be 33. And so this time we've made sense out of this problem using a representation that was very much connected to our concrete. When students are getting good with the representation, we need to then make that next step and get them ready for the abstract. Now again, that doesn't mean putting our pictures aside. We need to use those pictures to teach that transition into what's going on with the abstract. So let's take a look at our addition problem again and see what that connection will look like as we transition from the pictures to just the abstract reasoning. Now, one of the things that we saw is that there's always going to be some level of abstractness in a problem, whether you're giving that to the students in written form or you're having students write their answer that way at the end. Unless you're doing everything verbal, if you take the time to have students write something with digits, there is some level of abstractness. And so what we need to do in this transition is just make those connections. So one of the connections that we can make is that we had ones that were being added and tens that were being added. So when we modeled that, we had seven ones and six ones. And when we came up with that total, we knew that there were three ones left over and this additional 110. Really what we showed was that there were 13 ones. So what does that look like with our abstract work? When we put seven ones and six ones together, we're gonna get 13 ones. But we don't want to think about it as 13 ones. We wanted to think about it as 110 and 3 ones. So what we do in our abstract work or algorithmic work is we're going to write the 3 in the ones place, and then we're going to carry that extra 10 to remind ourselves that we have an extra group of 10 from our set of ones. And that's what we drew right over here. Now we're going to put all of our tens together, just like we did before with our representation. We had 2 that we started with and that 1 that we were able to form from our group of ones. Well, here we have the 2 tens that we started with and that extra 1 that we formed from our 13 ones. So now I can see that I have 3 tens, and I can write that 3 in the tens place, understanding now that as 3 tens and 3 ones, or the value 33. And so this is just one way to connect the representation to the abstract work that students are doing. So now we've made that jump and we're having students work in the abstract. And we've seen these algorithms. We know these different algorithms that we expect students to be able to work with. The important thing, though, is that we continue to make connections back across this sequence of instruction. A lot of times what you're going to see is when students get good with the abstract, they're going to still be thinking the same way as they were thinking with the concrete and with the representation. And they might be using some of those things along the way, especially if they get stuck making sense out of a particular problem. For us to be able to get students to monitor their own thinking, we have to make sure students understand this connectedness across the entire sequence of instruction for CRA. So let's take a quick look at what that might look like for this problem 17 plus 16. If you gave the student 17 plus 16, and you expected them to work with this concretely, one of the things you might find is that a student says, okay, well, 7 plus 6. I don't remember what 7 plus 6 is. I haven't memorized that fact. And so you might see them off to the side go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Oh, that's a set of 10 and an extra 3. So that means I would bring another 10 over and write my 3 down below. And now they've got 3 tens, they add up, and they get the sum of 33. So this student didn't do the entire problem with the representation, but when they got stuck with the abstract addition of 7 plus 6, they were able to use a quick picture to help them model their thinking with the representation here, and also reinforce the idea of that caring. So what you're going to see when students are self-monitoring their own thinking, a lot of times is going to be a partial use of a representation or a concrete way to work the problem. But really, they're going to be able to handle the majority of that with the abstract thinking. So, just to kind of recap, one of the things we know as we work on CRA with students is this doesn't happen in one single day. This is a process. And we do not work this entire sequence of instruction with one individual problem. Now, we just did that in the video, but that was to help us to see the connectedness. We need to plan for students to first understand the concept and then introduce them to the concrete way of thinking. We need to make sure that we plan to teach them how to connect that concrete work to drawing pictures that are going to be the representation so that they can then work representationally to make sense out of problems. And then we're going to have to give them an opportunity to practice this way. Finally, we're going to need to teach that transition into the abstract, and then we're going to need to give them an opportunity to practice in the abstract. And while they're practicing in the abstract, we need to make sure that we're making connections across all of these different representations so that students are able to monitor their own thinking.